also very good this year at the Engineers. We were founded in 2008 and started more as a plant mathematics consultancy company. And in particular, running mathematics workflows. And we're a very early adopter of clouds, in particular Amazon AWS. And we now shifted more towards a project focus, and that's not a random list of products. So what we found running programmatic workflows is actually one of the bottlenecks in running the workflow is actually having the data curated in a meaningful way, so that when you're spending lots of time and effort processing and analyzing the data, you can actually know what you're looking at. So having a useful catalogue is a lot of products, and automating that process of curation, which is another bottleneck, is the and actually valuing the data that you've got there, so you can actually find data assets which are interesting. So the question you were answering is what people's going, but I'm not going to focus on those at all. So we run the programmatic workflows using a tool called throughput. In fact, we've adapted this in some ways, which I'll go into. But throughput originates from EDI, and here it's used to in production of genomics webbrowser called Ensemble, which is one of the first few genome webbrowsers. And this process obviously involves quite a large amount of compute resources, so there'll be gene build predictions, comparative genomics, and lots of other basically trying to represent most sequenced organisms from the genome browser at once. So they use eHive to do this, and so basically it's got a good track record of being scalable, reproducible, and robust as they release versions, for example, in 2 months. So these workflows are very complicated, and thank you to Maxim for introducing Metagenomics for me. So hopefully that's a sort of a flavour of how complicated this analysis can be with all sorts of different mathematics tools written by different people and different institutes, chaining this together on a large scale. There's a number of compute resources at UDR as well, for CPU years. So that's the starting point for eHive. But it's written at UDR to run on the cursor for Fedora, and there's an FQ farm. I hope that's a new threat in the future. Here I'm just outlining one of the interesting features of eHive is that we don't just schedule millions of jobs into LSF. What it does is it starts an autonomous worker which itself requests jobs from a central job list. So this is different to many other workflow engines. And it also has some advanced data flow features, so we can do sorts of branching and branches within branches. And we could play from a set analysis step. For instance, if we have a QC step, for example, and we decide that it hasn't passed, we can send that job onto a different branch of the pipeline rather than waste lots of compute resources and money processing something which is actually not really quality. So we have all sorts of features like this. I'm very interested in hearing about kernel workflow language as well. So eHive is not currently compatible with kernel workflow language, and the main reason here is that it has a number of features which are just not represented in CWR at the moment, but hopefully in the future maybe it will be. So yeah, for Eagle, then we want to run our workflows in a cloud environment. So there's obvious ways to do this is Dockerizing, and so that's what I'm just sort of talking about. How we did that. So the ability to use RSS is actually sort of a plugin to eHive. So adding another plugin to send jobs to Docker, and not jobs to send a request for a worker as a Docker container, that's fairly straightforward. But the next problem that we have is where do we send that request to? So this project now is probably going back a couple of years ago, so there are different technologies now. But at the time, there was no auto-scaling cluster, which is what we really wanted to schedule our containers. And the absolute requirement is that we want to be able to specify a memory use for a container and CPU. And some schedulers will have load balancing facility kind of aimed at some scaling web application where the load pressure goes up. That's normally suitable for many bioinformatics tools which might happily sit there not really looking like they're doing much stuff else, and then suddenly demand 100 gigabytes of memory, for instance. So we want to be able to factor that in and have control over that. So that didn't really exist as well. And we wanted something that was a cost platform idea. So in the end, we decided to write our own, building on good tools that were already existing. So I'm sure everyone's heard of CloudSwarm, as we've been talking about clusters quite a lot today. So this is the native Docker scheduler for a compute cluster. As I say, we didn't have any auto-scaling picture. I went to the third-party tools a couple of years ago either. So what we did is we wrote some very lightweight RESTful interface, which is called the Docker Swarm Orchestrator. We've written that in Go, and we're using the developer machine API and the Docker Swarm API today, obviously, of these choice technologies. And they've put it together very well. So Docker machine is does all the difficult work of figuring out how to start an instance in whichever cloud platform that we're on. So we don't need to do that. So that's worked very well. In fact, it supports VMware as well. We need to do that. As I mentioned, eHive works slightly differently by submitting requests to a worker rather than submitting the job itself, and then that worker will then put a job and then do another job and etc. So on this what we call the worker, what we have is the bioinformatics tool itself. So that could be Shine, for instance, as we mentioned earlier on. And we need to have some sort of a wrapper code to run this, which is called Runby. So what we've done is to build this into a Docker image. And our level code is in the GitHub repo, so each worker, each part of our workflow is now a fully independent step. And we use Docker Hub to store these. So having this work step allows us to do the more sophisticated sort of data plane pattern job and handles all the what can be quite sort of fiddly with our tools can have hundreds of parameters and options so make sure the files that we need for that stage in the workflow and if not, we can log to message, we can exit that point. Again, rather than just want to go into the job and then and figure out what comes on next time. So basically, there's more work in making It's a working unit, but when you put into it in the workflow is simpler, and you have to use all the components. So it's kind of a long-term investment. And so this is how we pulled this together. So we start free hive running a workflow. People make a request to the DSO, which will then try to schedule that container. And if needed, it will start up more virtual machines. And then it will schedule that container across the across that cluster and Docker Swarm does that for us. So you don't need to worry about where the container is in the cluster. When that container's first run, it's pulled from Docker Hub, so Docker Swarm does that for us, and pulls it across the Swarm, which is like as well. So actually some of our images might be 1 or 2 gigabytes. We have not noticed anyone's network provides with this, because one reason being maybe that's what's called across the Swarm when that first job is run. So then if there's another 10,000 jobs doing the same stuff, we can go to the images in there. So the container starts running, it requests a job from the eHub central database, it starts processing that job, it will probably fetch some input, and that would be from file system, processes the job, writes the output, again back to an Amazon S3 bucket, for instance. And then it will write the status and the report back to the eHub database. So that's how all these things are put together. So this was a really big change for us. So prior to this, we had lots of tools installed on one AMI. If you're running an Amazon, for instance, and that has all sorts of problems, because you have conflicting dependencies, you have you want to make a change to your workflow, you need to make another AMI, etc. So we now have one workflow step on one workflow image, and that has tests, etc. So this is great, but so the next question though is, what's actually on that image? And this is sort of an interesting question. I'm just throwing some questions at me, because I think it very much depends on your use case. What is you're trying to do? And I think, as we mentioned, a lot of the Docker has a focus on microservices. So this is a very good use case as we're running containers. Processing very large amounts of data on a long time. We're not running So yeah, first question is how was the image built? What's an image? So a very obvious question. And we shouldn't be trusting an image that we don't know what's on it. So I'll just use an example. Just sort of last week we had an issue with a Sharm installation. So I went to Docker Hub to look at a few images and see how they were built. So, and there were several pages from them. Some were very good standard and others were not. So the first one I found, there was no Docker file. So I don't know how that was built. I think we looked at it much more. So there are solutions to which we could talk about the file that's very involved in use in the Docker community. Those other options for configuration management. So does the build still work now? So the next container I looked at for Sharm, it has a successful build status. So Sharm's working, sure enough. But it didn't help us, because we were trying to actually understand how to install Sharm for ourselves. And so what had happened is that the container had actually been built 2 years ago. And in those 2 years, some of the underlying dependencies had changed. So if that build was run again, where we have the Docker file, the image was not good. So that was not a reproducible image. So I'm just sort of putting that as an interesting question. There's sort of solutions here, and then continuous integration to just build it correctly. So we build all our images once a week, so we know if there's a change and something's going on, we can compare that with previous builds and see what dependency is a change. So in the case of Sharm, actually, it was H5PY. Needed to be a slightly other version, so in the latest with install, the same instruction you get in the newer version, that would open the whole Sharm. So we weren't actually using H5PY, but any of the scripts in Sharm were picking this up. So none of it works. So it does at all actually work. So a very obvious question, I guess. Maybe a better way is about thinking about how do we test the image. So again, yes, you could do that in the .par. You can add some tests to run the .par. We use Seattle, which I'm going to. And lastly, probably not applicable to many people here, perhaps, but I'd be very interested to hear about similarity today. We're actually in a situation where we'd like to deploy this e-hive system to an HPC where Docker is not an option, but similarity is. Do we want to be too tired to pick your approach and being able to adopt files or another approach to these things? Again, completely dependent on this case. So this is what our setup looks like at the moment. So we have a vulnerable GitHub repository in the bottom left here. And so we can make a commit. If you make a commit to Rumble, we change how the code is working so that the jobs process go differently, then that will trigger the code of our image. So we're actually using Chef to build the images. It's an interesting choice at the moment. So again, it's kind of a use case thing. We've had a background in automating the bioinformatics workflows, so we have a lot of tools already written in Chef cookbooks. So switching to Docker was very easy because we just not have to build a sort of containment state of showing the answer of our processes for us, it has a very good framework for testing containers, so we can write more sophisticated tests. So containers can be a safe threat. It's a good framework for testing infrastructure. So we can run service rec or shut some inspect. Again, we don't actually need to install a check at all to run inspect. So that's a very good tool for running tests. So we can run basically tests for two version thing that it says it is when you download it. It's not, we haven't had cases where you download the tool, it says it's version 1.5 and you do I can help or something like this, and it says it's 1.6. So, interesting. So, we can put a test in here to do simple stuff like that. If it's all actually a test, some of our practice tools do, and some of it, then we can run those tests to make sure that it's installed correctly. And, of course, then we have tests for our vulnerables, So we test for our data input is correct, and we can test the data flow, and we can give it some test data, and the sequence file should produce this output, which has a checksum of XYZ. This is all handled for us in Travis, and if this is good, successful, then we push that image to Docker repository. So we push up to type of automated build, we just avoid the latest type when we use that, and that goes then into kind of further workflow testing. And if that's all fine, then we'll type that back Docker to version 1, version 2, whatever. So when we come to the final workflow, we'll deploy it to customer, we know we've got a particular version of Docker image for each step of the workflow. And the nice thing is, if we then want to change that workflow in the future, we can make a number, and we're changing some of our rumbles, we can make a number tag for those rumbles. And we know that our old workflow is going to work in exactly the same way, and our new one can use the features of those rumbles. So, I'd just like to, I realise I mentioned Greg in the abstract, so I thought I'd better talk about it a bit. So we also added a more centralised logging system to eHive. So we're just using this fairly standard sort of throughput Elasticsearch banner. So each worker logs to throughput and that gets written then into Elasticsearch. And we visualize that with Kibana. And it's a very nice way to make that person dashboards like this very easy. So at the top we've got job counts and then errors and warnings. So we have different types of lockover and messages and counts. The colour scheme on the count doesn't scale very well, so that's a sort of early version of it. What we found here is that we were running a job called new data, which is basically filtering out human sequences from all other sequences. We just want to get rid of those because we're interested in human sequences. And what we're finding is that it was taking longer than some of the functional assignment steps later on. So that's not very optional. But at the same time, it was working. We weren't getting any errors. So because we're using Docker Swarm, we were able to use Docker Stats, which gives you the memory requirements across every machine, every container in the Swarm. So it's a very basic way to start looking at metrics of containers, but it's a very easy tool. And what we find is that the step was actually using most of its memory. I think we originally gave it 7.5 gigabytes. So it was working, but it was taking quite a long time. So, don't want to sort of go through all the goodies and options too much, but basically, because we had this step with tests in it, test data, and we can run the whole workflow, we have test data to run the workflow as a whole, we can play around with So interesting thing was we just increased the memory for the read data from 7.5 to 30 gigabytes, it basically run a lot quicker. We also tried out some of the other options for so we reduced the time from maybe 7 hours to just under 1 hour. We're actually using our Spot instances, many people are using sort of their internal compute clusters, so you might not have as direct awareness of the cost, but if you're using cloud provider, then that's a fairly big focus. So that was quite a big reduction in the cost. Quick summary. So we managed to authorize an advanced open source workflow engine that's no exaggeration, so it's transformed how we develop workflows now. And so having deployments production system really aids the people just to think about how they do the software industry, how we put it together. So that's the PDR, you have and all these people at Google, who are at Google, who been developing the extensions that we've done for Eagle Hive, for being involved in the platform, and we'll talk about that. So thank you very much.